Hopwood was born here 42 years ago in the small farming community of David City, Nebraska, surrounded by cornfields and cattle. He was a bright, cocky, stubborn kid from a solid family, and he hated rules. A good athlete and a miserable student who won a basketball scholarship to Midland University and partied his way out of it in one semester. He drank himself through a two-year hitch in the Navy, then added drugs to the mix when he returned to David City, working in a feedlot. He was broke, unrepentant, and frustrated that things weren't going his way.
Ran in the bank with guns, yelled at everyone, grabbed as much money as we could. We never intended to hurt anyone. The guns were there pretty much for show. And then we left and dumped the stolen car and got into a grain truck, because this was August in Nebraska and no one's gonna think about bank robbers being in a grain truck.
The idea was to stick up very small banks in tiny towns like Gresham, where there was no police presence and little risk of armed confrontation.
We wanted to get in and out of the bank as quickly as possible. When they arrested me, they searched my car and found $100,000 in cash that was directly traceable to the bank I had just robbed, and multiple guns and a scanner and binoculars.
They had you.
They had me.
When he entered the federal penitentiary in Illinois in May of 1999, he was 23 years old.
So people were trying to fight their cases, and I didn't want anything to do with that until June 26th of 2000. The Supreme Court handed down a decision called Apprendi v. New Jersey. I, like everyone else in federal prison, thought that this might apply to the federal sentencing guidelines. So I started learning the law on my own and was never able to get any relief for myself. But what I found was I enjoyed solving this legal puzzle and kind of writing out the solution. So I started helping other people in prison.
Did you decide you wanted to be a lawyer while you were in prison?
I did, but I didn't think I could. I had had countless number of lawyers tell me I could not go to law school. And even if I could, I would never get licensed by any of the state bar associations, given my crimes.
The University of Washington Law School took a chance on him. He won a full scholarship from the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and upon graduation, was admitted to the bar. He did well enough to land a prestigious clerkship with the United States Court of Appeals for the District of Columbia, the second most important court in the country.
The idea that a convicted bank robber was going to go work for Janice Rogers Brown, a very conservative judge on a very important court, surprising in the absolute sense, yes.
And the cops go to the
house. A year later, it led to a highly competitive teaching fellowship at Georgetown Law's Appellate Litigation Clinic, where he did so well, the faculty awarded him a position as a professor of law. Hopwood's main interest now is criminal justice reform. He's an advocate for shorter prison sentences for most crimes and more vocational training, drug treatment, and mental health counseling.
All right, let's give it up for Shon Hopwood. You know, Alex mentioned that as a church, we're all about rewriting stories, or actually about God rewriting stories, and yours is one of those incredible roller coaster stories. I want to ask you a question that's maybe a most important question first. I know that you've lived here in Nebraska for a while, and then you went to Illinois, back to Nebraska, Washington State, and now you're in Washington, D.C. Probably the most important question is, are you still a Husker fan?
Of course, very much so.
All right.
Some things never change.
Yeah, good, good, good. Have you been to a game lately?
We went to the Maryland game a couple weeks ago, which was a lot better outcome than last week's game.
That's for darn sure. And tickets are cheaper in Maryland than
much
they are
cheaper.
In Nebraska.
It's easier to get tickets there than it is here.
Yeah. So this whole bank robber thing is actually pretty intriguing as a piece of your backstory. You're 21, 22 years old. I just want to ask you about that. What were you thinking?
I wasn't. You don't get that many bank robbers up here on the stage with you.
We don't usually put them on stage.
So I was a young, reckless, immature young man. Didn't think about consequences. Didn't think about long-term consequences on myself, let alone how my actions would impact others. And so you take that and you mix it with other young men that are the same age going through the same things, and it turned out to be a recipe for disaster.
And as a result, you wound up getting what turned out to be 11 years in the federal penitentiary.
Yeah, I had to stand before Judge Richard G. Cuff in a federal courthouse in Lincoln and was sentenced to 12 years and 3 months in federal prison. Not my best day.
Yeah, for sure. So take us through, you know, there's oftentimes, you know, on Netflix and so forth, you got prison dramas, all those kinds of things. How is prison like or unlike what people might conceive?
You know, I think it's like what you see on TV in that there's the ever-present threat of violence. There's not a lot of hope in prison. But it's different than what you would think in that, you know, I grew up in a family where no one had been to jail or prison. I thought prison was where the evil people went. And then I went to prison and realized it wasn't evil people, it was just people. And that for whatever reason, some didn't have a whole lot of opportunities to begin with, and some like me that did have opportunities squandered them and made poor choices and poor decisions, but that most of the people I saw in the prison system had the ability to turn it around if they were just given a little bit of help.
And practically, where did you go? Take us through your little route.
So I was sentenced, and then I was sent to, Nebraska does not have a federal prison, so I was sentenced to Pekin, Illinois, at a medium-high security federal prison. And I was there for nearly 10 years. And by the time I was finally released from custody, it was April 2009, I had served like 4 months shy of 11 years.
Wow.
Long time.
And in prison, there were three things that would be, I think I would characterize as major redemptive aspects of your story. And I'd like to ask about each of those. First, you had some romantic redemption. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
I did. That's one of my favorite stories to tell. Especially now that my wife's at this service. I'm kidding. So, my wife and I grew up in the same hometown, the sprawling metropolis of 2,500 people in David City, Nebraska. We knew each other, but not well. And I had no idea that my wife would have been interested in me back then because, you know, she's very smart and beautiful, and I'm not. And she became friends with my mom after college, and they were both working for her dad back in David City, and she asked my mom one day, like, what's Shon up to? And she said, oh, Anne-Marie, Shon's in federal prison for robbing banks. And you would have thought that would have been the time to say, okay, thank you, Becky, and Annie would go on her way. But for whatever reason, she decided to send me a postcard.
At which point you ask, what was she thinking?
Yes. And that postcard turned into several hundred letters and phone calls and visits.
Wow.
And we just became really close friends through these forms of communication that, you know, I mean, letter writing's largely extinct these days, but you say things in letters that you wouldn't normally say face-to-face. So we had a very deep friendship.
Wow, that's powerful. And it's a deep friendship that wound up turning into a romance and then a marriage?
Yes. So 3 weeks after I was released from federal prison and custody, I proposed to my wife, and again, not sure what she was thinking, but she said yes.
It's amazing.
Right over down the street at, we were telling the kids this, all the places people propose, I decided to go for surprise. And where to surprise her more than good old Whole Foods.
I thought you were going to say at the post office where your picture was still up. So we got to say Anne-Marie's here, and they've got two kids, and Anne-Marie just got her degree in law as well. So give it up for Anne-Marie for being a huge part of this redemption story and an ongoing piece of what God's doing in amazing ways. So the second piece was your vocational redemption. Like, you started working in the law library. Take us through that route.
Yeah, so I had knew nothing about the law. I had not finished a bachelor's degree, certainly had never gone to law school, and got a job in the prison law library, mostly because it was easier to check out books than it would be to wash tables, what I was doing in the kitchen. And really didn't want anything to do with the law until the Supreme Court handed down that decision that I was hoping would lead to a sentence reduction. And, you know, there is no greater motivator and incentive than early release from prison, because, you know, the thing I quickly realized about prison was I did not like it. There was nothing good about it, and so that was a big motivator for me. I was never able to get any legal relief for myself. Thanks, Judge Cuff, who's now a good friend of mine. We actually took pictures in his courthouse this summer from the bench where he sentenced me. So you want to talk about a strange life.
It's like a victory lap right there.
But then I started writing legal briefs for other prisoners, and one was for a man named John Fellers, who was also from Nebraska, and we filed his brief in the Supreme Court. And you got to understand, the Supreme Court of the United States doesn't just accept all cases. They get 7,000 to 8,000 petitions a year. They grant 70 to 80 of them. You have about a 1% chance of having your case heard. But that 1% chance is for lawyers filing briefs, not for indigent federal prisoners who don't even have a lawyer, and who, instead of, you know, printing out nice and neat copies, pecked it out on a prison typewriter. To get a case like that heard's about 1% of 1%. And so when we filed that brief, no one really thought this was going to happen. And miraculously it did, and then 2 years later, I got the court to grant another case, and then I won a case in the Sixth Circuit Court of Appeals.
Did you win those cases in the Supreme Court?
Well, I got them granted. The case, John Feller's case, I can't actually say I won because a lawyer took over, and not just any lawyer.
Which was a good idea.
Yes, well, you know, they don't like to let prisoners in jumpsuits argue in front of the Supreme Court of the United States. And so we needed a lawyer, and we caught a big break in that the lawyer who was up on the video, his name's Seth Waxman, he was the former Solicitor General of the United States. The Solicitor General is the person who represents the United States government in every case before the Supreme Court. And he was in private practice, and you know, he's a phenomenal lawyer. If someone argues three or four cases in the Supreme Court, they are considered a Supreme Court expert. Most people will never argue any. Most people, even those that are experts, argue five or less. Seth Waxman's argued over 80 cases in the Supreme Court. And so to say we got a good lawyer is an understatement.
The justices are his homies.
Yes. And, you know, he's represented, you know, some small companies like Apple and Twitter and Monsanto and you know.
Hopwood.
Yes. And he's just been a good friend and mentor to me. And we won that case unanimously. And John Fellers ended up getting time off his sentence and beating me home.
Wow. That's amazing. So third aspect of redemption, it wasn't just romantic and vocational, but there was a spiritual thing that God did in your life while you were in prison. Talk a little bit about that and how he brought you home.
Well, I mean, God started drawing me closer to him just through struggle. You know, I think it's easier for people at rock bottom to seek God than people who have a lot of success and are living in a mansion. It's one of the reasons why I think prison ministry is so important. But I just started to see that, you know, there were patterns in my life that, you know, I knew nothing about the law, and here, through the worst part of my life, the worst struggle, I end up in the prison law library. The Supreme Court grants these cases, and, you know, I would love to be able to tell everyone that was because I was the most brilliant lawyer and hardest working person on the planet. But in actuality, you know, I was a guy who hadn't taken freshman English in college. And so, you know, I just come to realize that it wasn't, felt like I was being pushed in a particular direction. And then, you know, I became a Christian once I got out, when we started attending church at this place called Christ Community.
That was awesome. It was awesome. And I remember getting a chance to baptize you along with Marty Barnhart in the other venue, and that was a great triumphant day as well.
Yeah, Annie and I both got baptized over in the gymnasium, and we've been on quite the whirlwind ever since.
It's amazing. And tell me, what was significant about your time here when you were at Christ Community? I think it was 3 years you hung out here?
Well, so, you know, the first 2 years someone's released from prison are the two most precarious years of whether or not they're going to be able to stay out and be successful. And the reasons are, you know, not hard to imagine. You're taken away from your family and friends and community and everyone you know. You're placed into a concentrated area with a bunch of other people who have also committed crimes. I mean, what could possibly go wrong? And then you get out and you don't have job skills. You don't have, you know, no one wants to hire you. It's hard to find a place to live. And almost every successful reentry story I've ever saw and witnessed involved people coming out and feeling like they had community, mm-hmm. feeling like they were getting a second chance. Mm-hmm. And for some people, that's college. Some people, it's nonprofit. Some people, it's work. And some people, it's in churches. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we always felt welcomed here. We did not shy away from our story. In fact, we were just with some people that on Friday that we had met through our small group here. And I'll never forget the time in our small group when, I don't know how it got brought up, but it was maybe one of those things where you have to say one thing that's false and one thing that's true. Mm-hmm. And I said, I'm from Kansas and I spent 11 years in prison. And everyone was very certain I was from Kansas. And boy, did my small group get an earful that night.
Oh, I'll bet. You know, it's fun because my recollection of you and Anne-Marie being here during that time was just, if we saw you in the halls, you would go, well, there's an ordinary, nice-looking young couple. Like, there would be nothing that would seem extraordinary until you got into conversation and found out a little bit more of your life. And it just makes me think of how many people there are who are here right now who are ordinary, you know, nice-looking young people or middle-aged people or even older people. But when God gets a hold of your life, He sets you on a brand new trajectory that can take you to entirely different places. And that the hope and life change that's available here for ordinary people that are just walking our halls is amazing.
Yep. Well, I mean, struggle is universal. You don't mm-hmm. have to go to prison to struggle. And people that come out the other side of that usually have a lot of things to offer to the world.
Yeah, that's very cool. So now you're a associate professor of law at Georgetown University, is that right?
Yes.
And very exciting stuff. Tell me, like, when you wake up and walk to work, what goes through your mind?
Usually the millions of things I've got going on during the week. I've got a pretty busy schedule. But I tell you that if you saw me walking up to the law school, you'd see a big smile on my face. And the reason is I walk from Union Station. It's a 3-block walk to my law school. And I cross New Jersey Avenue, and I look down, and there is the U.S. Capitol 3 blocks away, the big dome. And then I cross First Street, and I see the law school. But I also look down the street. From my law school, a block and a half from my office, ironically, is the headquarters of the Federal Bureau of Prisons. So most days I'm chuckling to myself as I walk up to the law school because honestly, I just should not be there. Mm.
It's amazing. Now, I know that you've adopted a passion at this point because I've followed your career. For everyone, just because Shon and I are friends, you know, I watch him on Facebook, I watch his YouTube videos, I kind of follow what's happening. And for me, it's been a huge education just learning about a world that I don't know that much about, the world of the prison system. Here's a few statistics that I've come across since doing some of that research. One of them is this, incarceration in the United States. The prison population has gone up from 300,000 in the 1970s all the way up to over 2.3 million people in prisons today. Can you believe that? We have 2.3 million people in prisons today. The United States incarcerates people at a rate higher than any other country in the world. The United States does. 737 people per 100,000. We put people in prison more than Russia puts people in prison in the United States. Isn't that crazy? If you think about a population, just take somebody who was born in the year 2001, 1 in 15 people will spend some time in their life in jail or prison. And if you're a black male, 1 in 3 will spend some time in prison during their lifetime. And the spending that goes with that is tremendous. Spending has gone up from $6.9 billion in 1980 to $80 billion today. And you go, man, if we're spending that much money on the prisons, how are we doing in terms of helping people to come out and live successful lives? Well, the answer is pretty pathetic because 3 out of every 4 people, or 75%, wind up going back to jail
after they're let out of jail. There's a 75% recidivism rate. So you think about a failed government program, that's about the definition of how much failure there could be out there. So Shon, I know you know these statistics, you live them all the time. What are some of your reflections on the prison system and mass incarceration today?
Well, I think we're finally starting to see a ramp down of the tough on crime area, where we're reevaluating things finally. And I think part of the reason is the system has impacted so many Americans. 113 million people have had someone in their close to immediate family who will go to jail or prison in their lifetime. That's an astronomically high number. You talk about, you know, we claim to be the land of liberty on one hand, but on the other, we know that we incarcerate people at a greater rate than almost any other country on the planet. And, you know, if I thought putting 2.3 million people in prison actually kept us safe, kept crime down, and solved the root issues of crime, I would still be up here screaming how unjust it is to punish people like this. But it turns out that it doesn't make us safer, and in fact, a lot of times, it perpetuates crime. I'll give you just an example. You know, the longer someone spends in prison, the less likely they are to come out and be a law-abiding, successful citizen. Now, you may say, well, maybe that's because something's wrong with their character, or it may be that we've put them in this horrific environment where there's a threat of violence every single day, where the message implicitly and explicitly is you are worthless, you're a piece of garbage, and that it's only a matter of time before you get out and commit a new offense. You know, the whole system as a whole needs to be reevaluated, and the one thing it needs more than anything else is some good old-fashioned grace.
So I love that you've got kind of a theological backing that's behind this. You know, that whole idea of grace and second chances that comes from a Christian worldview intersects with your prison worldview. Explain a little bit about that.
Well, I tend to use it through my introduction. I introduce myself the same way, usually, no matter if I'm at a church, a Rotary Club, the U.S. Senate office. I gave this introduction to the President of the United States, and I say, my name's Shon Hopwood. I'm an associate professor of law at Georgetown University Law Center, and I committed a violent crime, but I am not a violent criminal. And the reason I phrase it that way is people tend to think that someone who commits a crime, that is their destiny, that defines them for the rest of their lives. That is simply untrue. Simply untrue. People have the power to turn it around. Redemption's possible. As a church, we have to believe in grace and second chances. We're commanded to. And I just think if we had more of that in the criminal justice system, we'd all be safer. We'd spend a lot less money. And we wouldn't need to feel like we have to put 2.3 million of our fellow friends and neighbors in prisons all the time.
That's so powerful, because your identity is not your worst day.
No,
your worst day isn't who you become. You're a child of God. And your worst day is your worst day. It's something that you did, but it doesn't redefine you.
Well, just think about the worst thing you've ever done. Not what you've ever been caught for. That's different. Worst thing you've ever done. Now imagine if that was broadcast to the entire world and you had to carry that with you every single day. I feel like people forget that. And you know, most people don't do the horrific things that I did. But I'll tell you, I have had federal judges and prosecutors and FBI agents and, you know, some other people that are pretty high up in government in Washington, D.C., come say something to me, and I always know when it's coming. They'll be like, hey, Shon, I didn't rob any banks, but if I had got caught for the things I did in my teens and 20s, I would not be in this job today. And I feel like we've lost some of that recognition that none of us is perfect.
Man, and in the church, you know, with what Jesus did by dying on the cross, as the picture of forgiveness bringing second chances, we got to be all about that.
Got to be about second chances.
Okay, I know, give me a little word association here. Tell me what you think of this phrase, mandatory minimum sentences.
One size fits all solutions in the criminal justice system rarely work. And so, you know, what mandatory minimums does is force a judge sometimes to give sentences longer than they think is necessary.
And you said something in one of the interviews I heard you give about 5 years as a, like a number that's a good number, and beyond that, it doesn't cause a whole lot of behavioral change. Tell me a little bit about that.
Well, so right now our system's predicated on just punishment. We don't do a great job of rehabilitating people, and this should concern all of you, because 95% of people we send to the prison system are coming home someday. 650,000 people leave our jails and prisons every year in the United States. They're coming home to be your neighbors. And so to me, it seems incumbent upon us to make them better off, not worse. And too often the prison system makes people worse off, especially when you're talking about serving long sentences. Makes people, you know, their job skills deteriorate, their social skills deteriorate. They, you know, if they serve a long period of time, they may not have any friends or community to come home to. And you think about someone that gets out of prison after doing maybe 10 or 15 years, and they're living on the knife's edge, paycheck to paycheck, and maybe they lose their job for some reason that has nothing to do with them, and they have no community to fall back on. That's when people are put to the choice of homelessness or crime, and that's usually when crime occurs. And so we have to have interventions and help people before they get put in that position.
Now, there's a counter argument that would say, if we have longer sentences that are out there, 10, 15, 20, that would serve as a deterrent to keep people from committing more crimes. What do you think of that?
Well, if you, two things. In order for something to deter you, this idea that we give someone 20 years, it's going to deter everyone else, you have to first know about it. Anyone in here know the punishments for any of the 5,000 federal crimes that are on the books? Anyone? No, I asked groups full of lawyers this question and no one knows. So it's hard for me to think that's going to deter people. And then the other idea behind deterrence is people are going to respond rationally to that. But most crimes committed by young men 18 to 25, for you women in the audience, are young men 18 to 25 rational actors? Do they think about the consequences, the long-term consequences of their actions? No. In 11 years in prison, I never met one person who knew how much time they were facing. And so, you know, a lot of our practices in the criminal justice system do not map onto how human beings actually behave.
That's good. That's good. Now, I know that you're out to change all that. And last year, about this time, there was some landmark legislation called the First Step Act that got passed. Some of the most powerful prison reform legislation in decades, and you got to be a part of that. Tell us a little bit of your role in helping make that happen.
I did. I got a call one day. I never know who's going to call or email. I really don't. And it was from the White House saying, hey, we'd like to talk to you about doing criminal justice reform. And they said, we'd like you to come to the White House. And my first thought was, Secret Service is not going to let me in the building. But they did, and they let me in, and we had some good, productive meetings. And, you know, I like to say criminal justice reform is the last bipartisan issue in America. And so this bill was really important for a couple reasons. One, you know, it was, at the end of the day, modest reform. But on the other hand, it's the best reform to come out of Congress in my lifetime. And what it does is it puts in rehabilitation programs in the prison and incentivizes people to take those programs, become rehabilitated, and it ties it to the incentive of early release. It also allows some people to get resentenced who have been sentenced just way too harshly for laws that people initially voted for thinking that they would solve problems, but what these laws, some of them did, was create huge racial disparities in sentences. So African Americans were receiving 100 times more punishment than white people were. And so we needed to fix those things. And I was very fortunate that the bill got 87 votes in the U.S. Senate, which still seems strange to say out
loud. That's a miracle in and of itself.
It is. And, you know, the president signed the bill, and I got to be in the Oval Office the day that the bill was signed, and it was just a very joyful occasion. And, you know, it's one of these things where it's not always politically easy to vote for criminal justice reform, but people exhibited leadership. Senator Deb Fischer voted for it, and I thank her for that. Senator Sasse, we need to get him on the criminal justice reform train. But I'm working on that. But, you know, it's just a bill that will provide second chances to people. And there are more people like me in the prison system who are rehabilitated, who are not a danger, who are just warehousing for decades. And we tend to think it's just that person being punished. But so many of the men I serve time with have wives and kids at home. And all the data tells us, when a kid has a parent who's incarcerated, greater risk of mental health issues, substance abuse, behavioral problems, and going to prison themselves. Yeah. And the last thing we want is to create intergenerational cycles of crime and prison.
It's really good.
Because it just won't fix our problems.
Yeah, it's so good. Tell us a story. Tell us one, you know, fantastic, compelling story of somebody who benefited from the First Step Act.
Ah, oh, that has to be our the Hopwood family friend, Matthew Charles. Matthew Charles had a pretty rough 20s, committed some violent offenses, some ugly offenses, and when he gets caught selling crack cocaine, a judge says to him, you know, you are a danger to society, I'm going to put you away for as long as I can, and he sentences him to 35 years in federal prison. Matthew, what the judge could not have foreseen, though, was that Matthew had the ability to turn it around. He goes to prison, he meets Jesus, becomes a Christian. He does 21 straight years in the federal prison system without one little minor incident report. And what I tell people is, you can get an incident report for looking at a staff the wrong way on their bad day. And I'm often held up as the model of rehabilitation. I got 2 incident reports and 11 years in prison, and that's only because I got caught twice. So to go 21 years, pretty remarkable. Matthew files a motion. Judge cuts him loose. Matthew does everything we want of someone coming out of prison. He gets a job. He makes community at his church in Nashville. He gets a place to live. He gets a girlfriend who supports him. And despite the fact that Matthew doesn't have much money and he's only been out of prison, you know, after serving 21 years, he spends every Saturday morning volunteering for a soup kitchen for the homeless called, and I can't make this up, the Little Pantry That Could. And then the Department of Justice appeals his sentence and they win. And the federal judge has to bring Matthew back into federal court. And as 50 members of his church are in the audience, the judge has to sentence Matthew back to 9 more years in federal prison. Mm. It's then that I helped take on his case. He was a client of mine. We were trying to get the president to grant him clemency. It was clear to everyone, including people at his church who were very furious about what had happened, that he had been a changed man and was rehabilitated. And then the First Step Act gets passed, and Matthew, lawyers filed a motion, and he was the first person released from the First Step Act. A television crew from NBC, Lester Holt, was at the jail the day he walked out. And 2 weeks later, he was sitting in the US Congress at the State of the Union as the guest of the president. Pretty cool story about a guy who deserved it. But you know, there are thousands of Matthew Charles in the prison system, people like that who have turned their lives around, who are worthy of a second chance, that we should be identifying and getting them out. And that's kind of what I do today.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Well, speaking of the president, I hear one of the president's daughters is a law student of yours at Georgetown. Is that true?
That is true.
Can I ask, what, just between you and me and the whole internet, what kind of student is she?
So she was not in my class. She was my research assistant.
Oh, okay.
So she worked with me on a couple criminal justice reform things and did a great job. And, you know, I was very thankful that she came to work for me. But it is strange when you meet the president and he knows that you have supervision over his daughter. He always likes to ask me, how's Tiffany doing? And then I will say, great. And he says, well, she better be.
That's right. That's right. Good. Tell me a little bit about just how you're going about using your job in Georgetown as a way to help continue to stimulate criminal justice reform. What are the classes you're teaching? What are the things you're initiating there?
Well, I teach a lot of criminal law classes, which is not a surprise, and civil rights classes. And you know, I tell people that I kind of have 3 full-time jobs. So I I'm a law professor full-time. I've got a full load of classes and lots of students. And then the other third of my time I spend doing criminal justice reform work. A lot of that in the U.S. Congress, but also on the state level. In fact, I'd like to come back and help Nebraska figure out its mess with its prison system, because it needs some work.
There you go.
And then the other third of my time, I still litigate cases. And, you know, I've got cases in federal courts across the country, and I've got a new lawyer we've added to the team. My wife, Annie, graduated from law school in December, took the bar in February, became a lawyer this summer, and we just filed our first brief together a few weeks ago.
Yeah, congratulations. You're good.
But I've kind of got cases going on all over the place, a variety of different things. And, you know, what I really try to do is go around and just explain to people that taking someone and just putting them through crime, through punishment, does not fix things. I'll give one example. I do a program at Georgetown called the Policing for Tomorrow program. And we work with D.C. police officers, particularly young D.C. police officers. And I had this police officer tell me this story, and it's so illustrative of what's wrong with the criminal justice system. He said he pulls this guy over in a car who was driving with no license. And he runs his record and finds out that he had been arrested 15 times for never having a driver's license. Hmm. And he finally just asked the guy, why do you keep breaking the law and doing this time and time again? And the guy finally breaks down and cries, and he says, well, I can't take the driving test because I can't read. Mm. And so there are root issues of crime and why people are doing things. Mm-hmm. And sending someone away to a jail or prison does not fix those things. Mm-hmm. Nor does it make the victims of crime whole. You know, victims don't feel like they have been made whole and the harm has been repaired from the crimes committed against them just by sending someone away to prison. And so I would love to see a model that's based on a lot of what we do at the church, which is restorative justice, mm-hmm. helping alleviate the harm that the person caused when they committed the crime and getting at the root issues of crime. Mm-hmm. And if we did that more consistently and didn't send people to prison, we'd have safer communities, we'd spend less money on locking people up, and we would not lead the world in incarceration. Mm-hmm. And so there are ways we can fix this, but I need your help, church. I need your help.
Yeah, amen. I think we're with you on that. If you were going to ask the church for help, if you were going to say, okay, if people are warmed up and they're saying, I'm ready to help you out a little bit here, what would you say ordinary people in Omaha, Nebraska could do to help out with this?
Oh, that's easy. Go teach a class in prison. Go do prison ministry.
Teach a class about what?
You could teach a class about anything. You could go teach a class about how to manage a checkbook, because I did not know how to do that. Mm-hmm. In fact, that's why my wife manages all the money at our house, because I still don't know how to. You have lots of wisdom and insights and education that you can offer to people in prison. You can change their lives. Go start a book club in prison. You know, go teach a book of the Bible. Go teach someone how to get out and interview for a job. You know, you have so much to offer people on the inside, and you know what? If you go into prison and you go into jails, it will profoundly change you. I guarantee you. You will come out saying, you know, I had this idea of what I thought this was, and that's not true. And there are ways you can get involved right here. I was very happy when Mark, several years ago, I was still at the church when this happened, decided for the next church plant would be at the Douglas County Jail. Christ Community still has a ministry there. You have a member of the church named Jeremy Bowman who runs Rise, who goes into the prisons in Nebraska and teaches entrepreneurial classes. The people that take those programs and come out, they have a recidivism rate that's a fraction of what the national rate is. And so we know what will work, we just need more people involved. And so I hope that you will give the unmerited grace you've received from God and give that to people on the inside through the power of education and mentorship. And I think if you did that, you would see a drastically different criminal justice system. Again, you'd have safer communities, and you'd change lives and make families whole again.
That's good. That's good. You know, it's interesting to me that this was something that was on Jesus' mind when he first showed up and he unrolled the scroll in his home synagogue. He landed on the chapter in Isaiah 61, where he says, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me because he's anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free." And kind of on his top four list was one of those things of, God has brought me to help set the prisoners free. And if there are people who are unjustly imprisoned, man, is there any better good news than setting the prisoners free?
Yep.
I know you've been thinking about this from a perspective of common sense, but also from a perspective of the life of Jesus. If you're going to bring the intersection of those things, my prison experience, the life of Jesus, what words would you bring?
Well, I tell people that, you know, people that commit crimes can have redemption, and that we shouldn't always be so harsh to judge them. I'm certain you have all read the Apostle Paul a whole lot. Anybody remember what the Apostle Paul was doing before he became the Apostle Paul? Go back and read your Bible. It wasn't a pretty story. And he found redemption. And, you know, we have to have a recognition that everyone's human being with dignity and grace and worthy. And we shouldn't give up on people so easy. And if we had the incentive of where people thought that they went to prison, become rehabilitated, and truly are offered a second chance when they get out, I don't think you would see people continue to go back in and out of prison, in and out of prison. And that should be something that we all want. If we had more churches involved with giving grace in the criminal justice system, I don't think we would have 2.2 million people in prison. And so that's my call and my ask of you, is to go in and get involved and help with this problem.
I know you have a favorite Bible verse you like to share with people. Why don't you go ahead and share that with us here?
I think this is like the scariest verse in the Bible. For Americans, it's in Matthew. "Then he will say to those on his left, 'Depart from me, you cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not clothe me. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me.'" This criminal justice reform is we're all called to do it. You don't have to do what I do and be a law professor and a lawyer. There are things you can do right here at home. And I'll tell you, it's life-changing to watch people that you mentor in the inside get out and then have amazing success. You know, Mark was that person for me, Marty Barnhart, my wife, my family, that lawyer, Seth Waxman. I now get to do that with students and people I mentor in the prisons, and it's been life-altering to be on the mentorship side. And so, you know, I think it would be very rewarding for you, and I hope you will do that. Thank you, Christ Community, for having me back here.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, this is Shon Hopwood. Let's thank him for being here. Good job, man. Thank you so much. Bless you. Sean's heading out to the table where he's going to be signing some of the books. We were only able to get a limited number of his books called Lawman. This is the book that takes you through his story through prison until he landed in Omaha the first time. I think we've got 50 copies and one copy per family. If you guys want to go get those, you can pick those up out at the resource booth. And Sean would love to shake your hand, meet you, sign your book, do a selfie, whatever you'd like to do out there as well. He'd be happy to hang out with you and chat a little bit more. And before I let you go, I want to remind you that December is a great month at Christ Community to welcome one more person. Because at Christ Community, there's always room for one more. There's always an empty chair where we can invite one more person in to experience the new life and power of Jesus. Next week, you know, we've got the choir concert that'll be fabulous. There's a family night that's coming up. We have three services that are all going to be very helpful to be able to bring friends to. And then at the end of the month, the Stump the Chump on a Sunday morning that should be quite engaging as well. So with all those things coming up, why don't we stand together? And I'd love for us to finish off with a closing prayer here.
God, we praise you that you are a God of second chances, that your grace is sufficient, that your power is made perfect in our weakness, that your love is shown to people like Shon and people like me and all of the people who are gathered here today. God, thank you that we're not defined by our messes, but we're defined by our relationship with you. And I pray that as we walk out of here, we would remember that for ourselves, that you have loved us, and because of your love, we are a child of God. And we pray that you'll help us to remember that for other people that we encounter as well, that they're not defined by their worst moment, but instead that you're a God who changes lives, and we believe that you can and you will do that for your kingdom's sake. So go with us and fill us, we pray, in the name of Jesus, our Savior, our Sanctifier, our Healer, and our coming King. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen.